All right, we're going to go ahead and get started. Good morning, everyone. I hope you all enjoyed the first night of the conference and are ready for another exciting day. We also want to welcome those attending through YAF's virtual pass. If you're on Facebook or YouTube, you can register to participate at yaf.org/virtualpass so you can ask questions live. This morning, I am excited for you all to hear from a truly insightful speaker, Professor Brian Brenberg. Professor Brenberg currently serves as Executive Vice President and Chair of the Program in Business and Finance at the King's College. Before joining the faculty at King's, he worked in the financial services and medical device industries, as well as public policy research and philanthropy. Professor Brenberg is a graduate from the Harvard Business School, where he earned an MBA with distinction. He also earned an MPA from the Harvard Kennedy School. Professor Brenberg is also a frequent guest on several Fox News and Fox Business programs. He has written for many publications, including USA Today, Forbes, CNBC, The New York Post, and The Hill. His speeches have been covered by Time and The Washington Post. Additionally, he has spoken at several previous conferences and programs for YAF Center for Entrepreneurship and Free Enterprise, including the Foundation's annual Road to Freedom Seminar. Professor Brenberg is a friend of Young America's Foundation, and we are thrilled to have him join us once again today. So please join me in giving a warm welcome to our next speaker, Professor Brian Brenberg.
Thanks, man. Appreciate it. Well, good morning. I've been invited here today to talk to you about one of the dirtiest words in the English language. It's almost never discussed in polite company. Entire societies have actually tried to ban it, and that's because a lot of people think that the only way you can get it is by exploiting someone else. The dirty word I'm here to talk about today is profit. What were you thinking? Think about this. If you want to signal virtue to somebody, if you want to show somebody you're virtuous, you do not tell them how much you enjoy making money, do you? You talk about how much you love giving money away. Entire societies in our time and in the 20th century, entire societies have actually tried to ban profit by creating economic systems that eliminate it. And I think it's undeniably true that more and more people today think the only way that you can make a profit is by taking advantage of someone else. Profit is a very dirty word in our culture. And I think the reason, one of the reasons profit is such a dirty word is because in the stories we tell ourselves that inform our moral imagination, profit is almost always linked with the bad guy. And guys, I think that's very dangerous. Because profit-making businesses and profit-making entrepreneurs have done and have the potential to do so much good for the communities we live in and for the people most in need in the world we inhabit. That's why it's so dangerous. But I gotta tell you, it's not going to change. Profit as a dirty word is not going to change unless we start to change the stories we tell ourselves about profit. And to do that, we have got to regain, we have got to recover our sense of wonder. We've got to reform our imagination about what profit is and where it comes from. So that's what I want to do today. But I want to start with the reason I personally care about this. One of the reasons I'm really interested in this subject is because of a personal encounter I had with one of my students a few years ago. So I teach at the King's College in New York City. And one of my best and brightest students came into my office because she wanted some career advice. And she came in and she said, I'm going to go work in the nonprofit space once I graduate from college. And I need your advice on how to do that. And I said, great, that's awesome. Tell me why you want to go work for a nonprofit. And she said, well, I want to go work for a nonprofit because I want to make a difference in the world. And I said, awesome, that's great. I love that you want to make a difference. Why do you want to work for a nonprofit? And she said, well, I want to do good. I want to serve people. I want to help people. And that's where you go if you want to do good. And I said, okay, great. Let's talk about the products and services in your life today, just this day, that have been the most helpful for you, have been of the most service to you this day. Let's talk about those. What are they? And she had to think about that question for a second, which I found interesting, by the way. If I asked you, what products and services have been most, I'm looking actually at somebody right now. I'm not going to ask you, though. I'm just looking, but think about this. If I asked you what products and services have been most helpful for you today, I bet it would be hard for you to answer that question right off the top of your head. But I asked her this question. I said, what's been most helpful? And she said, well, let me think about it. I'm wearing glasses, and if I wasn't wearing these glasses, I wouldn't be able to see the things that I'm trying to read and the things I'm trying to do today. So I guess these glasses have been really helpful for me. And we're in New York City, and in New York City, we've got to walk around a lot, and I've got this pair of shoes on that they happen to be Chuck Taylor's, I think. And she said, these shoes are really comfortable, and they're really good for walking around New York City, so I think these shoes have been really helpful for me. And, you know, I've got this water bottle, and it's good to stay hydrated, and I'm really glad I got this water bottle, and I've got my computer in my bag, and I was just working on a paper that I was writing right before I came in here. And I had a cup of coffee this morning to help wake me up, and that was, I guess that was really helpful too. And I rode the subway into school today, and that was really helpful for me. So she listed all these things. And I said, all right, where did those come from? And it turns out, of the things that were most helpful to her that day, every single one of them was made by a profit-making company or organization, except one, the subway. And of all those products, that was the only one that broke down on her way to school. It was the reason she was late for her first. I'm glad you could laugh at that. She laughed at it too. So here's what happened. She sat back in her chair and kind of laughed at that because that was kind of funny. The one nonprofit involved in this story is the one that broke down. But then she, I'll not forget this, because she was one of my best and brightest students, very ambitious. She looks off in the distance. She's leaning back in her chair. And she looks off in the distance for a number of seconds. Like, there's silence in the room. And then she looks at me with this sort of pained expression on her face. And she leans in and she says, is it okay if I just want to go into business? She didn't ask me a strategic question like, hey, what should I do with my skills and my interests? You know, what path should I chart? She asked me a moral question. Is it permissible for me to go into this sector of the economy? So I was stunned by that question. I was not expecting a moral question. And I thought about it for many days afterward. But as I thought about it, it started to occur to me that that question she asked me actually wasn't that weird. And the reason is because the stories and narratives that have shaped her imagination about business have almost always pushed her in the direction of questioning the morality of the marketplace. Think about this in your own life. Think about this in your own life. Think about the characters in some of the movies that you grew up with and you loved. Now, you guys are a little young for this, but for the older generation in the room, and I include myself in that, people like Gordon Gekko were some of the most memorable characters in film when it comes to what is business entail? What is business about? Gordon Gekko from Wall Street famously said what? Greed is good. That was his mantra. If you're a little bit younger, you guys, my kids included here, it's guys like President Business, right? President Business, the arch villain. They don't even try to hide it. His name is President Business. Business is in his name. And of course, he happens to be Lord Business, the most evil guy in this society. I remember my kids watching this film. I love this movie. But I remember watching it with them and thinking, my goodness sakes, I am totally undermining my entire profession by having my kids watch this movie right now. Your own thought experiment. Try to think of a movie, film, even a TV show you've seen where the business person is the good guy by virtue of the business he or she runs. Try to think about a movie or film or story where the business person is the good guy. So I did this experiment myself. I don't see that many movies, but I've seen a few, and I was thinking about, gosh, what movies have I seen where the business guy is the good guy? And I came up with a couple, but I don't think they quite fit. Okay, so Bruce Wayne and Tony Stark are both business guys, right? But they're not heroic because of the businesses they run. In these movies, they're always the hero in spite of the business they run, right? Bruce Wayne sleeps through business meetings. He saves the world when it's not 9 to 5. He's a business guy, but he's not a good guy because he's a business guy. That's the kind of portrayal of business we often get in film. At best, you're good in spite of business. At worst, you're the bad guy because you're in business. Or think about religion for a second. So this young woman that I was talking to in my office happened to be a Christian. I'm a Christian as well, so we share a common faith commitment. And if you're somebody who spends time going to church on Sunday mornings, think about this. When's the last time that you heard a sermon or a homily that painted business, painted the act of trying to earn a profit in a positive light? Try to think about the last time the pastor or priest spoke to his or her, his congregation and talked about the marketplace in a way that was affirming to the people sitting in those pews. Just ask yourself if you've ever heard that. The answer almost surely is no. When it comes to that institution that often most powerfully shapes our moral imagination, the marketplace, business, profit is almost always absent. We talk about charity, we talk about missions work, we talk about money often as the root of all evil, or the love of money as the root of all evil, but we often don't, almost never talk about what it means to operate in the marketplace. And of course, think about politics. The evil corporation, the big business, is almost always the bad guy in any political discourse. You'll hear it day in, day out, all the way through the 2020 election. So think about this. Think about these institutions that shape how we think about the world. Film, religion, politics, the message is almost always the same. Profit is the thing the bad guy does. Profit is the thing the bad guy goes after. So why is it? Why is it that profit almost always gets portrayed this way? Let me give you one answer. Let me give you one reason why I think this cultural understanding is so ubiquitous. Villains are interesting. We have a keen sensitivity to injustice. We want to understand why things in our world don't go the way that we want them to, and villains help explain that. And so stories about villains are powerful to us. They're interesting to us. But the mundane good guy, the 9-to-5 good guy, that guy is totally uninteresting to us. Now, that doesn't mean we don't like good guys. We like good guys. You think about Captain Sully landing a plane in the Hudson, rescuing his passengers. It's heroism. That's great. We love the heroic good guy story. The pilot who can land a crashing plane. But the story we do not care about, and it's a much more common story, it's much more ubiquitous. What about the mechanic? What about the airplane mechanic who works for 40 years of his career, 40 hours a week, day in, day out, changing oil, fixing parts, making sure those crazy aircraft, it's a miracle that they can fly. These guys help make sure that can happen. Do we ever think for a second about that mundane good guy who keeps us alive? I'll tell you, there's only one time. There's only one moment where we think about a guy like that. Do you know what it is? When your flight's delayed. Because he's sitting on the plane fixing something. And you know what we do to him then? It's terrible. It's terrible. Give him dirty looks and curse him under our breath. That's what the mundane good guy gets most of the time. But think about it. It's the mundane good guy that makes our lives work. From the breakfast that you're eating this morning, to the water bottle you're carrying, to the podcast you can listen to and you enjoy, it's mundane good guys that make that happen. If you want, you can eat Cheerios every morning for breakfast. Do you ever get up in the morning and say, yes, Cheerios exist? Did anybody say that this morning? But it's a miracle that we've got that kind of breakfast, nutritious breakfast food available to us like nothing. So cheap, so available, right there. That is mind-blowing stuff that doesn't ever come close to blowing our mind. Here's the problem. I think G.K. Chesterton put it exactly right. He said, we are perishing for want of wonder, not want of wonders. Our world is full of things to marvel at. And we just don't do it. This room is full of things to marvel at. That light is totally amazing. Totally amazing. These tables you're sitting at, unbelievable that we can have so many of these. You're smiling at me like, what is he talking about? I know, I get it. There's a bathroom right down the hall. Do you know how awesome that is? Sometimes I do, like when I really have to go, I know how awesome it is. We don't. This was just an aside, this was kind of brought to my memory again. This week I've been reading a biography of the great baseball player Babe Ruth, who grew up in Baltimore in the very early part of the 20th century, late part of the 19th century. They did not have like underground sewer systems in Baltimore. Their waste flowed through the streets where Babe Ruth grew up. I'm like, my goodness sakes, I need to say thank you for underground sewage systems. You and I need to say thank you. But we don't marvel at these things. We just take them for granted. And here's why. Because we have lost the ability, we are losing the ability to ask a question. It actually starts with a question. We're losing the ability to ask a question that all of us have a deep desire to ask repeatedly when we're little, but then we're taught to give it up. I have little kids. There's a question they ask all the time. And the question is, why? Why is that here? Why does that look like that? Why are we going there? Why? It's actually a really annoying question if you're an adult, because it takes work to answer it. If you ever want to get to the bottom of everything, ask the question why five times of something. You get there, but it's hard. And when you're a busy parent or you're a busy professor, look, I even do this with my students, I have to admit. When somebody asks you why, the strong temptation is to say, you know what, just stick with the program. Shh. Just stick with the program. The program. So why do we stop asking the question why? Because some of our most important authority figures in life have taught us to stop doing it. But why is the question of wonder? Why is the beginning of gratitude? It's the question that keeps us from taking things like bathrooms for granted. I think if we're going to recover our wonder about profit, what it really is and where it comes from, we've got to stop being lazy and we've got to start asking why. And I'll tell you, the reason I think this is because it mattered in my own life. My own understanding of profit was shaped strongly by asking that question at a very particular and very challenging moment for me. Let me tell you my story. We talk about stories here. Let me tell you my story of profit. It starts actually with my grandma. 13 years ago, she was diagnosed with an abdominal aortic aneurysm. So what's that? Let me tell you, okay? Coming off of your heart is this huge tube called your aorta. It's like your body's blood superhighway. This thing matters. Boy, does it matter, okay? And this tube comes off your heart. The blood rushing out of there is going very fast, and that's great, except for as you get older. When you get older, the tissue in your aorta, in that pipe, starts to weaken. And when it does, that rushing blood coming off your heart can get in between the tissue, and it can create this big pool of blood. You can see there the abdominal aortic aneurysm. And that, folks, is a major problem. Because if that sac of blood ruptures, which it is likely to do, you are dead in minutes. Even worse, it's very hard to tell if anybody has one of these. Often abdominal aortic aneurysms are asymptomatic. You don't know if somebody has them until they're dead. That was the situation my grandma was in. We were so happy to know, like to learn that she actually had one of these. That was a miracle. But then the question is, what do you do about it if somebody has one of these aneurysms? Well, for most of the 20th century, this is how you fix this problem, okay? And I'm going to explain it to you in some detail because it matters, okay? Here's what you do. You've got this big pool of blood in your aorta. So what a surgeon does is they make a huge incision in your abdomen, open it up. They find that, you guys are like, this is breakfast time, buddy, stop this. No. You need to hear this story. Here's what happens. They find the aneurysm. What do you got to do to fix it? First, you got to clamp off the blood flow through your body's blood superhighway. Not a great thing to have to do. Then you've got to cut out that aneurysm, and you've got to sew in its place a plastic tube, all while your blood flow has been clamped off. Does that sound fun? But it's not about fun, right? It's about risk. It's intensely risky to go through this procedure. You can imagine that for an older person to go through this procedure, intensely risky. And it's hard to recover. You spend a couple days in the hospital, in intensive care, you might spend a week or two at the hospital and you'll spend months at home recovering from this surgery. Okay, so that's my grandma's situation, and this is one of the ways that, this is like the primarily the traditional way that you can treat this thing. But where the story got especially interesting for me is that the same summer she was diagnosed with this problem, I went to work for a company that had invented a really different solution. Okay, so this solution you can see is very much from the outside in, right? The company I went to work for created a solution that was totally from the inside out. This is the product right here. It's a little plastic tube with a handle that you twist and a button that you push. And at the end of the tube is a little plastic sheath. And let me show you how it works, okay? So instead of making a big incision in your abdomen, right, and clamping off blood flow, you don't do that. All you do is you make a ballpoint pen tip hole in someone's leg, and you run that tube up their femoral artery until it gets to that aneurysm in their aorta. So it kind of snakes its way up there. And when you get there, you press that button, and you twist that handle, and that little plastic sheath comes out, and it covers up the spot where the blood was getting in between the tissue, and it stops that aneurysm from growing, and it gets blood flowing the right way. No huge incision, no clamping off blood flow. You don't spend weeks in the hospital and months at home. You spend maybe 2 days recovering, and you're back up and you're back at it in life. So as a grandson, I was like, this is awesome. I can't believe this thing exists. But the entrepreneurship professor, the guy who's interested in how things come to be, asked the question, why does this company and this product, where did this come from? Why does this exist? And the answer to me was crazy, because this very sophisticated thing starts here in this old garage in Fridley, Minnesota. 1949. There's a guy in Fridley, Minnesota who owns this garage named Earl Bakken. I'll give you a picture. There he is. He's in the garage. A self-described tinkerer, okay, just a tinkerer, who noticed after World War II that a lot of hospitals were making much more use of electronic equipment when treating patients. And he's a guy who liked to tinker. So he went to the University of Minnesota Hospital and said, can I help you guys? Can I help fix the stuff that you're using on these patients? And they said, okay. So Earl Bakken was kind of wandering the halls at the University of Minnesota Hospital. One of the guys in those halls was a world-famous surgeon. I'll show you a picture of him there. There he is in the white coat. A world-famous surgeon doing path-breaking surgeries on kids with heart defects, okay? So he was finding ways to fix heart problems in kids that had never been fixed before. Totally amazing stuff. But what was interesting about the surgeries he would do is that after he would do the surgery in the kid's heart, in order to make sure that the heart kept working, he'd have to hook up the kid to a pacemaker. Now, do you know what a pacemaker is? Have you seen a pacemaker before? If you've seen a pacemaker today, they're like this size, right? They're just like the size of a silver dollar, maybe smaller. But do you know what a pacemaker looked like in the 1950s? It was like a little microwave. Only not so little, and it was heavy. And if you wanted to get it around, you had to roll it around on a cart. Okay, think from like silver dollar size to that. No mobility for the patient, right? But there's another catch. If you want to give that thing power, do you know what you have to do with it? You got to plug it into the wall. Now, do you see a problem with that? Halloween night, 1957. Power at the University of Minnesota Hospital goes out. No backup generators kick in. That surgeon has a kid hooked up to a pacemaker whose life he had just saved. And that kid didn't make it. You can imagine how the surgeon felt, right? My gosh, I've just saved someone's life, and it's over because the power went out. So the surgeon was devastated, but he also wanted to find an answer. How do I fix this problem? These pacemakers are a problem. So where does he go? He goes to the graduate students in physics at the University of Minnesota. Those are the guys who can fix things like this, right? They're being trained to understand exactly this problem. They should be able to fix this. They don't have an answer for him. But he had gotten to know that tinkerer, Earl Bakken, who'd been roaming around the halls. And so he said to Earl, "Hey, Earl, this is the problem I've got with these pacemakers. Do you think you can do anything about it?" Earl Bakken goes back to that garage, and 4 weeks later, he comes back with a battery-powered pacemaker the size of a few decks of cards. That's it. 4 weeks later, he comes back with that. And medical devices were not really regulated at that point, or at least not very heavily, so that doctor could basically try it on his patients right away. And it worked. And that was the beginning of the pacemakers that you and I know. That was the beginning of Medtronic, the company that I worked for that summer. That was the beginning of the treatment for my grandma's aortic aneurysm. That was the beginning of all those things. Medtronic is worth $100 billion today. And Earl Bakken, who passed away this year in his 90s, was a billionaire. Those guys made an awful lot of profit. A ton of it. Still do. But they did it by subordinating their interests to that kid's needs. Earl Bakken didn't need the pacemaker. That kid did. And they took the profits they made from that thing and they reinvested it in new devices that can help your brain and your throat and your nose and your heart and your lungs and your stomach. All of these different problems that people would have, that's where the profit was reinvested back into to save the lives of people like my grandma. Now, why am I telling you this story? This is an interesting story. Why am I telling it to you? Here's why. This is why I'm telling you this story. Because undoubtedly you've never heard it. But there's not a single person in this room who's heard that story, which is a tragedy. But I bet there's a lot of people in this room who have heard stories about drug companies that rip off their patients, who charge too high of prices, about hospitals that haven't done a good job, about companies like Theranos that have robbed people and defrauded people. You've heard those stories, but you haven't heard this one. And I think that's a problem. Now, this is not my point. My point is not to say that we should assume companies are good, that we should just think uncritically and say all profit-making companies are good. That's not what I'm saying. But here's what I am saying. We have to stop lazily telling only the stories where the villains are interesting to us. I think that's lazy. If you want to be countercultural today, if you want to do something different than everybody else, ask the question, why, about the things in your world that matter and figure out where they came from. We need, here's what we need a lot more of in our world. We need a lot more economic archaeologists. We need to unearth those stories that rekindle our wonder about the world that we live in. That's a challenge I want to level to you. My view is that this is actually a very practical talk. There's something that you can do with this. My challenge to you is to be a storyteller, to look around your world at something in your world that actually makes a difference in your life, a product or service that you can say, this makes my life better, and ask yourself, do I know where it comes from? Do I know how it started? Do I know the root of the profit that company makes? And if you don't know the answer to that question, then find out. Do the research. Do the work. My guess is you're going to come up with a story that's really interesting. It's not going to be perfect. It's going to have mistakes. It's going to have flaws. Everybody is flawed. But it's going to be interesting. And it's going to give you a different picture of what heroic looks like when it comes to business. Find that story. Ask why. And when you do, then tell it. Tell it in a way that makes sense for you. Maybe you love to paint. Maybe you love to write. Maybe you love to speak. Maybe you like to podcast or blog. Maybe you like to paint murals. I don't know what you want to do, what you love to do. But I bet there's a real diversity of skill in this room. My challenge to you is when you find that story, find some way to express it and share it with somebody else. And here's why. Because the fact that profit is a dirty word in our culture is dangerous. It could stand in the way of people, entrepreneurs, discovering what they're made to do and changing people's lives. And I don't want that to happen. So my challenge to you is find that story, ask the question why, use your imagination, and redeem a dirty word. Defend something that has very few defenders. And I bet that if you do, you might not only inspire somebody else to live out their story, but you might also find that it's inspired you to live out your own story. Guys, it's always fun to be able to share these thoughts with you. Thank you for being such a wonderful audience. I really appreciate it. And I think we've got some time for questions now. Is that right? I'm looking in the back. Great. I know we've got some folks joining online who might have questions, and folks in the room could ask some questions as well. How can I be helpful? How can I elaborate? What can I challenge? What do you want to challenge me about? Yeah.
I was wondering why you think, I guess in this case, like the Democrats make profit like a dirty word. Like, how would they necessarily benefit from that? And why did it become such a dirty word? I mean, probably the easiest answer is like,
well, I think actually, so I won't even make it a partisan thing. I think a lot of us can really easily slip into the thinking that if somebody's made a profit on me, it's because they've taken advantage of me. I think that's very easy for any of us to do. I think even to assume, because it's so easy for us to take for granted what we have. So you walk in and you've got to buy I need to buy a chainsaw. I do. I've got all this brush I need to cut down. I really need to buy one. And I need a new drill too, but we'll stick with a chainsaw. Home Depot sells a chainsaw. It's a cordless, actually battery-powered chainsaw for cutting down small brush. And it's $199. And I'm like, golly, that's a lot of money for a chainsaw. Those jackals at Home Depot for charging $199 for this. Why can't, you know? I don't even bother to ask myself, well, why in the world might it be priced at $199, number one? But number two, I don't stop for a second to say, God bless America that chainsaws exist. Because it's a heck of a lot easier to cut down a tree with a chainsaw than with a handsaw. It's a silly example, but I don't even bother to ask that question. Why do I think politicians do it all the time?
Like Bernie Sanders.
I did show a picture of Bernie Sanders. Can I be honest? Okay, here's my honest answer on this one. And this is true of all of us. So I'm not, again, I don't want to paint as a partisan thing. But real economic understanding starts with humility. If you want to understand this is a better answer to the question you asked. If you want to understand, like, what is the fundamental thing you have to start with in economics if you want to have a right understanding of economics, it's humility. Because the truth is, none of us know where the next great thing is going to come from. We have no idea. We have no idea what the next great thing is, and we have no idea where it's going to come from. That is the economic problem. How do you bring good ideas and smart and capable people to the surface in an economy so that they can do the thing they're made to do? That is the economic problem. But in order to solve it, you have to start with the understanding that you don't know the answer. But here's the problem in our world, in our political discourse. There are so many politicians who act like they have the answer. If you just let me make the economic decisions, if you let me just direct what people do and how to do it and where, we would solve our problems. You've maybe heard some politicians in the 2020 race say, "I have a plan for that." There's one in particular who really loves to say that. She's actually made a thing out of it. "I have a plan for that." Folks, I gotta tell you, that's the beginning of tyranny. When somebody in power says, "I have a plan for that." So what I'm saying to you is, I think the reason that prophet gets a dirty name, because it exists in a world where we don't know where good things are gonna come from, and prophet is one of the signs that shows us, oh, here's a thing people like. People like that thing, let's do more of it. Prophet is that signal in a world of uncertainty. But there are a lot of people who don't want to live in a world of uncertainty. They want to make the rules. They want to make the plans. And profit gets in the way of that. Companies get in the way of that. They want to take power. So I think it's a humility issue, actually. We've got to be humble enough to know that we don't have the answers. I hope that's helpful and gets you somewhere close to the question that you asked. Well, they want to be viewed as virtuous, right? What was Google's tagline as of a few years ago anyways? They always said, "Don't be evil." Right? They were really interested in not being viewed as evil. And I'm saying to you that I think one of the problems we have is nobody views profit as a word of virtue. Do you ever tell somebody when you want them to think well of you, "Oh, I like making money"? Have you ever said that? Have you ever even come close to saying that? Nobody does that. If you want to signal virtue, you say, "I like giving money away." So why do those companies not talk about, do you know the only place in our country where we talk about profit on a regular basis is so sad. The only time we ever talk about it on a regular basis is quarterly earnings calls. And it's where it's just a number. This company made $1.14 per share. No story, no flesh and blood, just a number, quarterly calls. Why would Facebook or Instagram, same thing by the way, Twitter, why would these guys talk about profit when nobody out there thinks it's worth talking about? When it's not going to make themselves look better? They're not going to do it. I'm saying we've got to reinvent the story. We need more storytellers who can tell a compelling, interesting story about a thing nobody's ever thought about because they've taken it for granted. That's, I think, how you start to change that a little bit. So I don't know if I got quite to your answer, but thank you for asking. I appreciate that.
If you have one question, please come back to the line. And we also have our first virtual pass question.
Sorry about that. I didn't know that either.
We have our first virtual pass question from Donovan in Kansas City, Missouri. He wants to know, should healthcare be considered a right if it saves people's lives?
Well, here's the problem with considering healthcare is really important. Nobody can disagree with that, right? I mean, all of us should be able to say healthcare is a really important thing. The question is, what happens if you call it a right? And I just have a philosophical problem with that. Rights always have corresponding duties. If I can claim a right, it means that somebody else has the duty to fulfill that right, okay? So if I say I have a right to life, means you can't take my life, you have a duty not to take my life from me, okay? That I think that makes sense to a lot of us, right? Rights always have duties. So healthcare is really important. Healthcare is a life and death issue. But if you say healthcare is a right, do you realize what you're saying at the same time is that somebody else has a duty to care for my health? Okay, well, who is that? It can't be government. Government is just people. So you tell me which person in society has a duty to become a doctor, nurse, caregiver, whatever, to provide health care for me. Who is that person? And if they won't do it, do we have the right to compel them to become a doctor? I get why people talk about healthcare as a right, because it's just important to us. We want to make sure people have good healthcare. But if you call it a right, you have to understand you're saying someone else has a duty to become a caregiver. And I don't think a lot of us are uncomfortable saying to somebody, I'm going to throw you in jail if you don't go to med school. Actually, I want doctors that don't have to be compelled to become doctors. I want doctors to be doctors because they want to be doctors, because they feel called to it. So instead of talking about healthcare as a right, let's talk about how we open up the system so that more people are more enabled to become caregivers, right? People who want to can do it. So great question, Donovan. Thank you. I just think when you talk about rights, you can't forget that there's a duty involved there, and that becomes a much thornier question for us.
Hello, my name is Gideon Martin. I attend School of the Ozarks. My question is, what are some other words you think we have in society that are given a bad name that us as the next generation should fight to flip that?
Oh, that's a really really good question. Other dirty words in the English language that I can say during the course of this talk that need to be redeemed. I would say, I think the term business actually as a category has a slightly negative connotation for people. Here's one. I think the word liberty, as odd as that may sound to some of you in this room, I don't think the word liberty is a favorite among a lot of people in our culture, because they view liberty as kind of a code word for individualism or not caring or do what you want, abandon people around you who need help. Or they view liberty as kind of libertinism, do whatever you want. But, you know, you think about a word like liberty, I mean, there are many foundational ideas when it comes to the American experiment, but liberty is one of those. But we have to understand liberty correctly. And I think it's really important to think about liberty as having the ability to do the thing you ought to do. That's the way I think about liberty. I don't think about it as I can do whatever the heck I want. I think about it as I have the capacity, I live in a society where I have the capacity, I have the right to do the thing that I ought to do. There's an ought in there, in other words. It's not value neutral. Values matter, even when it comes to liberty. And I think that's a word, because it's been interpreted so much as libertinism, do whatever you want, be an individual, whatever, and it's detached from community. I think the word community is a word that should become much more a part of the, called the conservative lexicon. I think community has been co-opted, justice has been co-opted in ways that tend to work against liberty. I totally disagree with that. I think justice and community are at the very heart of liberty. Wouldn't it be interesting if we could start to link those terms a little bit more? That's an abstract answer to your question, but those are a couple of words that I think of that could really have some new life breathed into them. Thanks for that question.
Thank you.
Thanks for the one person who clapped back there. I appreciate that. You don't have to clap, I'm just kidding.
Hi, my name is Jesenia Rivera-Pulse from Hope High School. My question was, does economic fluctuations and changing in its cycles heavily influence people's idea of the word profit and just like its influence, and why?
Well, I think it's a great question, and I don't know how much it influences our view of profit, but I do think one of the challenges with, a really dynamic economy that produces a lot of new and good things, one of the side effects of that is that change can happen at an increasing rate. And that is really, really hard for people. I mean, it's really hard when you've got a skill set that has helped you earn a living, and then because somebody creates something new, we call it creative destruction, it actually makes your skill set no longer valuable to people the way that it used to be. That's a real problem. And I actually think that if you're somebody who's pro-markets, pro-capitalism, you have to be really sensitive to that issue and honest about the impact it has in people's lives. And we have to talk about real ways to address and help people in those situations. And by the way, just to the previous question, that's why I think the word community is so important. If your vision of liberty is primarily individualism, I don't think people are going to want to listen to you, and I don't blame them. Because what happens to that person who loses, maybe you have parents in this situation who were in a trade and technological change has made that trade no longer profitable for them. What do they do? Well, if conservatives aren't talking about community and the importance of helping your neighbor and living into your neighbor's life, walking alongside them and building institutions where there's interaction in the community, if we're not talking about that, then we have no right to complain about the way that people paint us. We have got to talk about freedom means living into your communities and being sensitive to the needs around you and making sacrifices, not because you're compelled by the government, but because you're compelled by a sense of what is right and true and good. Because you know that relationship is part of human flourishing. I think that conversation's got to happen in order for us to have the good parts of a dynamic economy without causing harm to other people. And I'm actually thankful that we're in a moment right now where I think we're having that conversation. I think the idea of liberty purely as individualism, I think, is fading for a really good reason, and I welcome that, frankly. So thank you for the good question. Appreciate it. Yep. No, you didn't have to clap. Now I feel bad. Now I feel like it's this pity clap.
Hi. My name is Ellen Lomazov, and I come from based independent Silicon Valley. So since I'm kind of in the hub of Silicon Valley,
yeah,
we watch a whole lot of Shark Tank. And so this is more of like a business question.
Yeah.
How do you find a morally and materialistically effective margin between your commercial price and the manufacturing price of a product?
Well, okay, so the manufacturing price is just what it costs. It's like the cost of the materials to make it, whatever. That's not, okay, you didn't ask for like economics 101, but now you're gonna get a little bit of it because you went there. Price is not a function of what it costs you to make something. Price is a function of how much people value what you make. So if you want to increase the margin between what it costs you to make something and what people are paying, you've got to help them see what difference it makes in their life. You've got to show them value. It's narrative. It's a story of how this thing, you probably hate advertising, so do I. But you have to understand that part of advertising is helping people understand how this thing might be valuable for them. There's got to be something in your life where you've bought it and you've been like, whoa, I didn't think I was going to like it this much. Okay, well, that's the story that as a maker, you've got to tell to somebody so that they say, I would be so happy to pay you 30% more than it cost you to make that product because the value to me is even beyond that, right? That's a win-win. When you get paid more than it cost you and they pay more and they get more value than what they paid you, that's why trade happens. Trading stuff is always a function of both sides winning. You wouldn't trade something if both sides didn't win. That's actually a really fundamental point that gets lost too. So as somebody who's pitching, if you watch Shark Tank, it's not about the product, right? How does the product change my life? What dent does it make in the world? Tell me that story. That's the differentiator. That's what the sharks look for when they think about investing. So thank you for that question. I appreciate it.
Hi, I'm Ian Simmons from Long Beach, California.
Hey, Ian.
And I was wondering, you did say that it is very important that we don't show profit as the bad guy. But then there was
unless it really, really is.
And then you mentioned the example of maybe the social media companies where if they did talk about their profit, then it would be detrimental to their profit. Mm-hmm. So what would you
I think I misunderstood her question. I think she was saying, why don't they talk about profit, the idea more generally?
Okay. Well, how would you deal with the situation where maybe showing profit as what it really is would be detrimental to profit itself?
I'll tell you, okay, so now I'll give you my totally opinion, slightly cynical perspective when it comes to social media companies. Here's what I think, just my personal opinion. We could talk more about this later. I think those guys should be really leery about talking about profit because I think it's actually becoming hard for them to tell a good story about the good they're doing in the world. Sorry. I think the reality of addiction, the reality of the social pressures and problems that 24-hour social media has created for people, I think actually those guys, if you're on Twitter, it's very gross, can be really, really, really gross. I think those guys are having a harder time making a clear case for the unambiguous or even majority good that they're doing in the world. And so I think when they talk about profit, because what drives profit for those guys? Do you know what it is? If you listen to an earnings call, you do. It's how long are your eyes on the screen? The more your eyes are on the screen, the more advertisers will pay and the more profit those guys will make. So it's like eyeballs on screen. Well, ask yourself, is that a story of human flourishing? Look, I'm with you. I spend too much time on social media. I'm not saying that I'm immune from it. But is eyeballs on a screen flourishing? So I wouldn't want to have to tell the story of profit for Facebook right now or Instagram because I actually don't think they're making money in a way that's in every way that's contributing to human flourishing. And I think they've got to figure that out. They're trying to figure that out, I think. But they're realizing, oh, boy, we stepped into something. We had no idea what the social implications were going to be, and we don't know how to solve it. Can I do one last plug on that? Do you know why I think that's part why that problem exists for them? Because I think Mark Zuckerberg was an amazing technologist, but I don't think he had been challenged in his life. This is total opinion. This is going to sound, but just let me say it, because it matters for your education. I don't think he'd been challenged to ask the big questions about life in a very rigorous way. Who am I? Where do I come from? Why was I made? Why does it all matter? Those are the questions that guide our understanding of human flourishing. Those are the kind of questions that are addressed in a liberal arts education. Like, what is good and beautiful and true? I don't think he thought about what is good and beautiful and true. I think he thought about what do people want and what can I do and how do we scale that? And then he came on the back end and said, oh my gosh, it turns out I need to start thinking about what is good and beautiful and true. How do I do that? And he's trying to do that in reverse right now. And that's, I think, why Facebook is sputtering so much, because they don't have good answers to that question. So why do I say, you can disagree with me on the Mark Zuckerberg piece. Why do I say that to you? Because if your education has not challenged you to think about what is good and beautiful and true, it's going to come back to bite you at some point. You're going to lack purpose and a sense of where you're going. So the good and the beautiful and the true matters. Make sure that you're in make sure that your education is challenging you to think through those questions. Thank you for that question.
This is our final question, and it's from Virtual Pass. Rebecca from Inglewood, California wants to know, if capitalism is better than socialism, why do so many countries choose socialism?
Well, thank you for that question, number one. So many countries don't choose socialism. I mean, if you look at the 20th century, the 20th century is really a story of more and more countries embracing the building blocks of capitalism. So property rights, the ability to trade, sound money. These are the kinds of things that countries have been moving toward. I think the movement in the 20th century was toward capitalism and away from things like socialism and communism. So the question might be, why today is socialism becoming so much more interesting to people in countries that have embraced capitalism? And I think the answer is because capitalism that's untethered from a sense of what is good and right and true. So just back to that last question about social media. If capitalism is only giving us things that are novel and addictive, people are going to get sick of it. And they're going to say, I want something else. I think that's part of the answer. I think the other part is that it's easy to take good things for granted. We say, oh yeah, I'm very comfortable with my world and I'd like to have more socialism. Without asking ourselves, well, if you did that, what would happen to the world that you enjoy right now? And I can tell you it would be different. And there are plenty of tragic stories around the world, including one with a neighbor to our far south right now in Venezuela, who is it's tragedy. And that's a story of socialism. So I think part of the issue is that we get comfortable with what we have and we think it's always going to be this way and it always has been this way. I think part of it is we live in an economy right now where there's a lot of things that are being made and done and we say, are these good for us? I want more meaning. And so I think that's why businesses and that's why we have the obligation to say, what are the stories that we tell to help people see the possibility of a market economy? I hope that helps. Thanks for that question. Thank you guys for being an awesome audience. It was really fun to be with you today.